Greetings everyone, I'm Adam Harriton, and in this video I'm going to show you 12 mushrooms that grow in your yard, and more generally speaking, on your property. A lot of people think that the best mushrooms grow deep within an old growth forest, or somewhere far from human civilization, but that's far from true. If you've got organic material on your property, grass, mulch, wood chips, compost piles, flower beds, straw, sawdust, old tree stumps, then you've got mushrooms growing outside your home, whether you see them or not. Now, before we begin with the list of 12 mushrooms, there are four important things that I want to mention. Number one, not all of the mushrooms in this video are edible. Notice that the video title isn't 12 edible mushrooms that grow in your yard. It's simply 12 mushrooms that grow in your yard. The reason for this is a good one. At least one of the mushrooms in this video may be potentially poisonous, though that's up for debate. And the edibility of others is questionable. However, some of the mushrooms are edible, and I'll be sure to tell you which ones those are. Keep in mind though, if you're spraying herbicides and pesticides on your property, you probably don't want to eat the mushrooms. Number two, this list is region specific. I live in Western Pennsylvania, so this list is most relevant to people who live in Eastern North America, and more specifically within the northeastern portion of the United States. In other words, this is not going to be a list of 12 mushrooms that grow in everyone's yard everywhere around the world. Nature doesn't operate like that, and neither do I. Number three, this is not an exhaustive list of every mushroom that is capable of growing in your yard. If that were the case, we'd be staring at a screen watching this video for hours, and you can only imagine how many irrelevant and disgusting ads would be forced upon you. Not my choice, by the way. If you don't see your favorite lawn-dwelling fungus in this video, it doesn't mean that I forgot to include it. I intentionally left it out. And number four, this video is not a replacement for a field guide or a mycological key. In other words, this video does not contain enough information on the physical properties of each mushroom. Instead, the video is meant to introduce you very briefly to each species and to encourage you to do more research on the mushrooms if you're interested in improving your identification skills. So, I probably lost a few people with those disclaimers because some people just don't like to sit through important introductory information. But to those of you who are still watching this video, thank you. I hope it was worth the wait. Let's now begin our discussion of 12 mushrooms that grow in your yard. The first mushroom in our list is the winecap mushroom. Some people call it the garden giant or King Stropharia, and the scientific name is Stropharia rugoso annulata. This is a mushroom that grows in mulch and in wood chips spring through autumn. Wine caps are edible, and they are among the most commonly cultivated mushrooms in the world. So if you don't have these mushrooms growing on your property, you can easily introduce them. Wine caps are medium to large sized mushrooms with wine red or burgundy colored caps. Gills are whitish at first, then grayish, and eventually purplish black. A partial veil covers the gills when the mushroom is immature, then it breaks to leave a cogwheeled ring around the stem, and the spores are dark purple, brown, blackish. Another feature to note is the copious amount of white mycelium that is connected to the base of the stalk. The second mushroom in our list also grows in wood chips, especially during the spring season, especially when morels are growing. These are spring field cap mushrooms. The scientific name is Agrosibe praecox, though many people simply refer to these mushrooms as Agrosibe mushrooms. These mushrooms fruit in prolific numbers. They'll grow in your yard, they'll grow in your neighbor's yard, they'll grow in parks, they'll grow in urban areas. Any place where there is plenty of woody debris, Agrosibe praecox can, and oftentimes will, become established. Spring field caps are medium-sized brownish mushrooms with brown spores, and an important feature to note for this species is the way the upper surface of the cap develops cracks. Regarding edibility, there is no one that I know who eats this mushroom. Continuing with mushrooms that grow in mulch and in wood chips, we have stinkhorn mushrooms. Now, stinkhorns aren't restricted to woody debris. They grow in all different kinds of areas, including in lawns, in flower beds, in the woods, and along trails. These phallic-looking fungi develop from a gelatinous matrix within a membranous egg. And as the fruiting bodies mature, the stinkhorns take on a variety of unique shapes. The fertile surfaces of these fungi are quite slimy and malodorous, hence the name stinkhorn. And the fertile surfaces smell this way to attract flies and other insects who eat and carry away the spores. Because hundreds of stinkhorn species exist, you may have multiple stinkhorns growing on your property. Interestingly, some stinkhorn species are edible. Next up, we have bird's nest fungi. So here we have an exception, because bird's nest fungi aren't technically mushrooms, but they are fungi and they probably do grow on your property somewhere. Mulch and wood chips are good places to look, but you'll also see bird's nest fungi inhabiting sticks and twigs and other smaller substrates. Bird's nest fungi are very unique. Inside their nests, which are mycologically known as peridia, you'll see little eggs, which are mycologically known as peridioles. Within the eggs are millions of fungal spores that are dispersed by raindrops. Most bird's nest fungi are very small and are very easy to overlook, but if you look closely in your garden beds, I bet you'll see them. The fifth mushroom that grows in your yard is a little yellowish or grayish yellow Bulbidius. What the heck is a Bulbidius? Well, Bulbidius is a genus of mushrooms that are generally not considered to be edible, but they're certainly worth learning because they probably pop up from time to time in your yard. Members within the Bulbidius genus produce fragile, brightly colored fruiting bodies with caps that are slimy, at least when immature. These mushrooms are typically small, they're short-lived, they produce brown spores, and they grow on all kinds of substrates, including sawdust, decayed wood, soil, and dung. Related to Bulbidius is the genus that this mushroom belongs to. This is a Canosibe mushroom, and Bulbidius and Canosibe are in the same family, the Bulbidiaceae family. More specifically, this is the milky cone cap mushroom, Canosibe apalla. This mushroom should catch your attention because it may be potentially toxic. Very small quantities of toxins known as phallotoxins are found within this mushroom. Perhaps not enough though to make a person sick. And besides, no one looking at this mushroom would even really consider it to be food. The milky cone cap mushroom is incredibly common in lawns, especially in the early part of the day when temperatures are cooler and when plenty of dew is present on the grass. By noon, this mushroom will often shrivel up and disappear from sight. Key features include its fragile fruiting body, its pale conical cap, its very thin stipe or stem, and its cinnamon brown spore color. If you see milky cone cap mushrooms growing in your dewy grass, take a look around and you may see little ink cap mushrooms growing nearby. Like milky cone cap mushrooms, these little ink cap mushrooms in the Parasola genus are extremely fragile and ephemeral. They appear early in the day, and by the time the sun beats down on them in the afternoon, they often shrivel up and become inconspicuous. The caps on these mushrooms are egg-shaped at first, then they open up and become umbrella-shaped and grooved. The overall size of the mature fruiting body is small, the stem is very thin and fragile, and the spore color is black. Some ink caps are edible, some are toxic when combined with alcohol, and Parasola mushrooms are just too small and fragile to be collected for consumption. The eighth mushroom in our list is taxonomically related to the previous mushroom in that it's in the same family, the Satharellaceae family. So the eighth mushroom in our list has a pretty cool name. It's the Weeping Widow, Lacrimaria lacrimabunda. This medium-sized mushroom often grows in clusters on the grass, many times near tree stumps. Overall, the mushroom is tannish brown in color. It's hairy, a partial veil is present and noticeable on younger specimens, and the gills mature to a very dark grayish brownish black color. And no surprise, the spore color is very dark brown to black. I am not familiar with anyone who eats this mushroom. Moving on, let's discuss an incredibly common yet often overlooked LBM or little brown mushroom. It's often overlooked because of its small size and drab colors. This is the mower's mushroom, aptly named because of its presence within lawns. This mushroom grows on many different continents, and it often appears in lawns after rain has fallen. The mower's mushroom often has a hygrophonous cap, which means that the color is two-toned because of changes in moisture levels. The gills become mottled as the spores mature, and the spore color is dark brown. It's not dark jet black, which would be the case if you found one of the special Paniolus mushrooms. The mower's mushroom, whose spore color is a bit lighter, is generally considered to be inedible, but incredibly common in lawns throughout most of the year. So we talked about some inedible mushrooms, we talked about a potentially poisonous mushroom, and we only talked about a few edible mushrooms. You're probably wondering, why doesn't he just focus on the edible mushrooms? Well, I don't just focus on the edible mushrooms because, look, you got all different kinds of mushrooms growing on your property, and a lot of them are not edible. But I'll tell you what, why don't we finish the video with three edible mushrooms? So for number 10 in the list, let's talk about the ringless honey mushroom. This is one of the first wild mushrooms that I ever learned, and I saw it while walking through the city of Pittsburgh. It was growing outside of somebody's apartment complex. This mushroom tends to appear during the summer season, and you will see occasional fruitings all the way through the autumn season. The ringless honey mushroom grows in dense clusters, typically from buried wood. You'll often see the fungus growing in the middle of a yard, but there's a good chance that some wood is buried in the middle of that yard. The cap of the mushroom is very dry, and it's usually covered with darker scales. And what really distinguishes this mushroom from other armillaria species is that the ringless honey mushroom contains no ring around its stem. And that should be obvious based on its common name. The spore color is white. This mushroom is edible, but it should be thoroughly cooked before you consume it. The 11th mushroom in our list is the meadow mushroom. The meadow mushroom is a very familiar sight in summer, lawns, fields, and pastures. And taxonomically speaking, the meadow mushroom represents a group of closely related species that all more or less look like one another. The meadow mushroom has a dry white cap, and it has pink gills that are not attached to the stem. These pink gills turn brown with age. A partial veil covers the gills in immature specimens. The stalk of the meadow mushroom is smooth and white, and it can feature a thin, ephemeral white ring. The spore color of this mushroom is dark brown. Now, the meadow mushroom is edible and tasty, though you have to be careful and not confuse it for a toxic Amanita mushroom. Some Amanita mushrooms are poisonous, some are deadly poisonous, and you should definitely learn how to properly identify Amanita mushrooms before harvesting meadow mushrooms. And last but certainly not least, the 12th mushroom in our list is the puffball. Upon seeing a puffball, especially from inside the house looking outside, your first thought is almost always going to be, that's my kid's soccer ball. But if you look more closely, upon closer inspection, you will see that this strange entity is entirely fungal. Now, a lot of puffballs can inhabit your yard. Some are large, like the giant puffball. Some are very small. Some are in between these extreme sizes. Regarding edibility, puffballs are generally considered to be edible, though you want to make sure that the inner fertile area is white. Older puffballs, whose spores have matured, will be yellow or olive or purple or brown inside, and at this stage, they're too old to consume. Keep in mind that a fungus known as the poison pigskin puffball exists. Its inner fertile area is white at first, but it becomes a dark purplish-black color at maturity. And the poison pigskin puffball is generally considered to be toxic in North America. Another word of caution with puffballs is that when you cut one in half, you should not see a developing cap and stem mushroom inside. Very young and immature mushrooms in the Amanita genus can resemble puffballs when the Amanita buttons are enveloped by their universal veil. So there you have it, 12 mushrooms that grow in your yard, and more generally speaking, on your property. Keep in mind that hundreds of additional species could have been added to the list. I left out shaggy mane, I left out earth stars, I left out false parasol, I left out morels, and I left out black trumpets. Yes, morels and black trumpets do grow outside of people's homes. I left out too many species for this list to be considered exhaustive and comprehensive. I'm okay with that, perhaps you are too, and besides, I have no idea what your yard looks like. But if you've got grass somewhere on your property and you've got woody debris somewhere on your property, then there's a good chance that at least more than a few of the mushrooms that we covered in this video can be found growing outside your home. But even if you don't find any of the mushrooms that we covered in this video, that's okay. Because perhaps you have something else growing on your property, perhaps something even more intriguing than a mushroom, just waiting to be learned by you. Now, mushroom specialists don't like to admit that last point, but if you've ever spent any time trying to really connect to a particular piece of land, you understand how true that is. Everything is worth learning. Don't let the specialists convince you otherwise. Thanks so much for watching this video. I truly appreciate it. I encourage you to subscribe to the Learn Your Land YouTube channel. I also encourage you to head on over to learnyourland.com and sign up for the email newsletter. And if you are on social media, feel free to give Learn Your Land a follow on Instagram and Facebook. Thanks again for watching this video. I'll see you on the next one.